do very much. Sorry for the duet. And I think it did justice even without music. So thank you. We are going to have the calling of the names, but in the interest of time, we shall call the names all at once, after which you will come up and receive your diploma. So graduate your diploma, please, and I will invite Dr. Rock and Dr. Clark to come and conduct this part of the ceremony.
Stephen Rodberg. Stephen Romer, Christopher Codrington, Lynette Codrington, Carlisle Dubois, Cambridge Francis, Fitzroy Gibson, Carl Harding, Gerald Hendrickson, Winston Jeffers, Alan Lee, and together with him, Kenneth McDonald. Raymond McKenzie, also from Tobago, Helen Ethan. David Collard. On behalf of his sister, Sharon Comino, will receive for Wendy Comino.
Dr. Comino.
Dr. Wendy Comino. Merlin Reed Edwards, our administrator and co-registrar. Carl Cipio of this parish. My name is Stanislaus of Tobago. Lucetta Thomas. We have a certificate of participation to be presented to Mr. Carol Lindsay, who very sadly and unfortunately disappeared from us 3 years ago. And we have no clue as to his whereabouts. We commend him to the eternal care and keeping of Almighty God, who knows and sees all things. Is any member of his family here? Nevertheless, continue. Thank you very much. There are graduates who are not present, and we call their names nonetheless. Jeffrey Austin and Eric Cox.
Thank you very much. At this time, we give them all a round of applause.
At this time, we have a special presentation to make. We have to adjudicate on 23 presentations for the diploma program. We have various topics. Those deserving honorable mention are the rite of Christian baptism by Fitzroy Gibson, family life, good, bad, and indifferent by Carl Harding, Marriage and Family Life in the Anglican Church by Dr. William York. Same-sex relationships, addressing the bias, Christopher Codrington. Bringing to the depths of our souls, Kate Wong. A practical and spiritual overview of a lay minister's life and experiences, Kenneth Francis. The practice of Christian baptism, a guide to catechesis in the Anglican Church, Lynette Codrington. Spiritual dance, where it came from, where it is going, Lisa Thomas. The experience of black people in the Anglican Church, Sharon Motley. But we decided that we would give the prize of best pieces to the Holy Bible, the true management text, a look at management strategies and principles in Holy Scripture. And we invite Mr. Paul Sipio, the writer of this dissertation, to receive the award. We have now the presentation of the Bible Study Facilitators course of Lent 2011. And we call you, all of you, to come up please at one time. We invite Professor, the Reverend Professor Maxwell Richards, Assistant Curator at St. Mary's, to deliver the certificates. Patrick Webb, Lynette Roberts, Winston Jeffers, Ronald Webb, Leroy Joseph, Rayanne Smith, Sheila Smith, Teresa Maloney, Jane Thomas Clark, Yolandi Woods, Imelda Green, Jennifer Scatterbury, Yvette McShine, Olga Skeet, Julie John George, Alvin Hackshaw, Marilyn Patrick, Rick Green, Ethan Wilson Trotman. We have the Know Your Faith series participants of
Know Your Faith series, a model for catechetics, catechetical teacher, personnel to conduct baptism, confirmation, and to do things for the formation. He will keep call from the Princeton community. It is the archdeacon.
We now have the Anglican Youth Leaders Know Your Faith series of Lent 2012. I wish to humbly apologize that these certificates were inadvertently not brought to the church this evening. We nonetheless wish to have the youth leaders please come forward and to be recognized nonetheless. Sharon Lamy and the members who are here present, please come forward.
Good evening, all. For Lent, we all participated in the Know Your Faith series, the Anglican Youth Department, and we had young people from across the diocese, as far as Point Fortin, and they came religiously for 4 Saturdays, half-day sessions, and they came to participate to do this with Canon Clark, Dr. Clark, Reverend Mongal, and Reverend Rollins. And so I take this opportunity to say thank you very much for doing this for us and really imparting knowledge and making us a lot more aware of what it is to be Anglican. And so we have Ms. Keisha Seeley. She's from the St. Margaret's Parish in Vermont. Seeley is from Australia. We have Ms. Anika Smart from St. Margaret's Vermont. We have Ms. Charlotte Dennis, St. Margaret's Vermont. We have Marilyn Caesar, St. Margaret's Vermont. We have Ms. Khadija and Kyla Ben from St. Sylvan in South China. Ms. Anissa Abel from St. Sylvan, Tacarigua. Ms. McDonald from St. Sylvan, Tacarigua. Ms. Allison and Ms. Young from St. Mark's Point Fortin. We have Ms. Carly Lynch from St. Andrew's Cooper. Ms. Natalie Springer from Holy Cross, Maryland. And Ms. Janet John from Trinity Cathedral. Once again, thank you all very much for participating and thank all of you for really helping us along on this journey.
Thank
you.
At this time, I call upon one of the graduates, Ms. Sharon Motley, to present our guest speaker of the program for this evening. Barbados, Dr. Theological, to make his remarks. for leading.
Should be hearing directly from the bishop, because I think it's important that the bishop be informed. informed view about what is happening in your diocese. So that's one of the things those people who will be joining the youth program will be enabled in your academic research in that way. As for the discussion this evening, we need to remember one thing about this Christian church. It started out of conflict, and it will always have conflict. When Jesus was crucified on the cross, it wasn't that he sat between two robbers. The Greek word is really bandits. Our Lord was charged with treason and found guilty. Conflict with the state. Mark's gospel is born of conflict with the temple authorities in Jerusalem in the uprising of 66 AD. Matthew's gospel is a reflection of the Council of Jamnia in AD 91. John's gospel is an ongoing tension with the Jews in the synagogue and eventually being expelled from the synagogue. Acts chapter 15, if you can ever get it back yourself, Galatians chapter 1, is a conflict between Judaism and the Gentile church as to what cultural norms are acceptable. In the last 2 years, the Council of Jerusalem has been followed on by the Council of Nicaea, the Council of Chalcedon, the Council of Ephesus, the Council of Trent, and on and on and on. And all of those things were born out of conflict, and the church entered dialogue in order to resolve that conflict. The one thing that our modern societies have not dealt with adequately is the conflict that emerged out of the liberalization of the 1960s. Dr. Lashley spoke at length of the name changing, the tension of identity and names, but coming up in the 1990s, 1960s, there were three movements that were emerging. How many of you remember the hippie movement? The hippie movement was a movement for liberalization of expression. It enjoyed the playing of drugs. It enjoyed freedom of sex. And that went on to be almost accepted. At the same time, coming out of the 1960s, was a feminist movement. And the feminist movement eventually got accepted. We now have women ordained in the church. And we have to recognize that the ordination of women came as a result of feminism. We may not like to accept that, but that's the word, that's the gospel. It came out of feminism. The other movement that started in the 1960s had to do with black people. Blacks could not be ordained in certain places of this world. And Canon George Layton Barbados will tell you that when he became a black rector in the 1960s, that the warden behind him back the keys and said, "I've never worked for a black person yet and I don't intend to either." And that word was a black person. And so coming out of the 1960s was a conflict of blackness. And we saw that being resolved. But one quiet movement that was emerging in the 1960s that nobody paid any attention to was the action or the conflict surrounding human sexual identity. And the reason why no one paid a lot of attention and speaks up the direction here is because the American Psychological Association deemed it improper early in the 1990s. Once that taboo had been removed, it came back to the fore. And once it came back to the fore, it is a movement that will not be resolved by the church. The Black Power movement was not resolved by the church. The feminist movement was not resolved by the church. And the gender movement, and notice I'm not using the word homosexuality, the gender movement was resolved, will not be resolved by the church. It will be resolved by society. And we need to recognize that process in which the world has been engaged with. And we need to recognize that most of the time, the church follows society by about 100 years or so. And that is one of the things that we have to be conscious of when we look at this whole process of identity and identity formation in the church. The church in the province of the West Indies is still struggling with a colonial identity. We, and I speak now, I can refer to this one, but if you look at our hymn book is 60% hymns ancient and modern. But that shows something about our identity. I'm not saying in a negative way, but simply to recognize it is who we are as church. And it's going to take time for us to move on, to remove that 60% for a hill. I may not be around when that happens. Maybe the next 200 years from now, maybe we have hymns that are totally Caribbean in our Caribbean hymn. But these things take time, they take dialogue, they take Indian conversations. And one of the things that I notice that whenever these decisions come up, you tend to get very emotional about them. The emotion was going very high this evening, and we cannot resolve any of them through emotion. They have to be resolved through proper academic approach. I had a conversation with chatting with the Archbishop of Canterbury in March this year, really this year. And I said to the Archbishop of Canterbury that one of the things lacking in the Anglican Communion is a way of integrating Anglican Academy with the resolution and the instruments of communion within the Anglican Church. And he said, Ian, you're absolutely right, and I thank God that I am no longer going to be there when that is being happened. But it's a challenge. The Roman Catholic Church is dedicated and dedicated beautifully. They have a congregation of faith and doctrine, and they have a magisterium. There is no such thing, no such instrument in the Anglican Church. And until the time comes that there's an instrument in Anglicanism to merge academia with theological reflection, with decision making, with experience, with scripture, with tradition, and all the formative factors of theology, we will continue to have these conflicts. And so the time has come for us to create a new year. I don't think what the Lord markers that the Anglican Church is going to provide. I think this is going to make the church a strong church. If we can only use the instruments at our disposal, to understand theological reflection. I want to encourage you, the people here in Trinidad, to continue that journey of theological reflection. Continue the engagement with the Diploma program. And don't let it stop there. Move on from the Diploma program. Go on and do Bachelor of Arts. Go on and do postgraduate studies. Because it is only through academic reflection, through theological reflection, sound theological reflection, that we are going to be able to enter conversation with these difficult areas of theology. We cannot bring a simplistic approach to them. I thank you, and not intending to give you a lecture, I love teaching, and any time I get before, I think one is teaching more. So my apologies to people who now continue, and have a blessed day, and may God continue to bless each one of you in your theological journey.
The first remark that I want to give is to celebrate my good friend, late friend, Dr. C.L. Goodrich. Dr. C.L. Goodrich, last thing he did in Trinidad is to preach. I think he told me his eyes were going at this time. He came to preach at the cathedral when I was in the office at the cathedral. And what a wonderful sermon my good friend Sion gave. And his dear wife, Janet, she was here at the first memorial lecture when she spoke and she shared with us. He cannot come every year because we are going in there. This is our sixth. But he has set a book which I think we ought to read. It is full with his reflection, his information about himself and other things that we can read from one of the eminent theologians. It was Dr. C.L. Goodrich who first started the Diploma in Theology. I have gone to Codrington to speak at the convention. And I spoke about the question of lay formation, lay ministry. He said, you know, money is need to start something like that. I will start a project of the college and we'll go home and begin such a program. We have about maybe 30 something years in at this time. And that's why we are here today, because of the very great insight of the great theologian that I see on the bridge. Read his book, and that's what I would like you to do. As you see, we didn't only concentrate for 4 years on these illustrious candidates of the Diploma in Theology, graduates now of the Diploma in Theology. We went out because we found our mission was not only at Bishop's Diocese, Bruce's Cathedral, but in the parishes, in St. Stephen's Prince's Town, in St. Clement's Anglican Church, and above all, the youth officer told me she wanted a program on the Know Your Faith series. And we did it for. We have another program where we're going to do social ethics, biblical and social ethics. And those who were asking questions about homosexuality and same sex, and there is a section, that's why we have 4 years, where you have to present people, but have to research, not just common. And I like the thing. But do research. And when you present a patient papers on abortion, euthanasia, same-sex relationship, or marriage and divorce, and what are the number of important issues. And one of the things that we in the guide must take seriously as Christian community is the wider ecumenism. We are living in a multi-faith and multicultural society. And one of the challenges that the deep-faith I had that morning, I was hearing things and nothing untoward. But our church was filled with many different religious communities. It was the aim of faith, opening the door to. And that mountain had a wish up. That mountain had Hindu, Muslim, Baha'i, and incidentally we are in your rooms now, the Baha'i Festival. And that day, so it was not only the Ethiopian Orthodox and myself and other Christian communities, Hawaii. Nothing in Trinidad is open without being interfered. And we Christians, the Christian community must not only talk about Christian unity, but the basis of our unity is that the world may believe that you have said it. And we live in a plural society in Trinidad. You have a minister of diversity. You have a minister of multicultural. And I interface with them at the ground floor. I'm sure the bishop does. I am the vice president of the IRO. And believe me, when I come sometimes to think I have tested it, and I have a meeting in one of the mandir, that's a Hindu temple, or one of the masjid or mosque. That's a Muslim and so on. So don't, Anglican, don't put yourself in a little wall, in a little community, and argue with one another and what is right. You are facing the challenges of a multicultural, multi-religious society. In National Thanksgiving Day, when we talk, it was even a religious day, it was politicized. all the speeches were done by politicians, headed by Madame Prime Minister. So this theology we teach in you, not to make you feel good and have a proven theology and I'm going to really talk on what time to carry us for the MPH, the PH, what I mean, all the H's we have continued for this. We want to do it. We want to do it here not because we want to have letters behind our name, but we want to do it here so that we can know our faith. Live our faith in a multicultural, multi-religious society. So, thank you for staying with me 4 years. 4 years is all a terrible lesson. Because there's too much to deal with. That final year, all they will tell you, they have to read all sorts of research. Yes, and law. All that. One of the persons we have here, she was doing her PhD, and she was coming from that. She has a PhD, she has a degree. So, she's not here today because in multi-faith, multi-cultural government said that is how she eats her food. So we can't prevent her from going. So I thank a sister, Sister Corina. I want you to become a member of the Diploma. And all you know, people are going to teach you to know your faith. Just know your faith for a rent. Know your faith for 4 years. And go to Parish and learn about how to interpret and understand the literature. And yes, I want to see without content. What's your content that you can use in the world? On the rest, we have powerful hymns that speak to the condition, the social and cultural condition. Today, I conducted a service for the Calypsonian Hall. 50 years of Calypso Review. In this study, comes Carnaval and in this study. And also, this is Calypso Month. And I had them with a teacher singing, really singing, and they were singing. We didn't have a choir, we didn't have a choir, and we all singing a cappella. And if you hear shawarios, and or singing, they will hear all the kind of singing. That's the constituency in the movies. And on Tuesday, my school, or my, who have the grandchildren, the same will be buried. That is a great master, Doki Marsha. That is the man. That is the guy that he brought this team man to the people. So we celebrate it.
That's the culture.
And yet we are learning literacy. And yet we will learn how to interact with people. So I thank you very much for that. And we'll be very happy to have you.
Thank you, Reverend. And good evening to you, sisters and brothers in Christ. Mine is a task and a pleasant task of expressing a word of thanks. Only this week I was looking at some scripture and I saw this note, this verse. It says, "It is safe to say this evening we can all tune our lips to the melody of thanksgiving." What beautiful words. Let me begin the process this evening, first of all, by thanking our diocesan bishop, Right Reverend Claude Berkeley, for gracing us with his presence this evening. We want to thank him for his guidance, his leadership, his inspiration, and his support. And we pray to God that he will live for many, many years in that spirit and in that spirit. Thank you. I also want to take the opportunity to thank Bishop Duclin. I was way long in the back, I saw him this evening. Dean, Samson, Archbishop Primus, and all members of the clergy who spare some time to come and do the business of. Thank you very much. I had the privilege a few years ago of meeting Dr. Ian Rock at a social function in Roraima. You probably don't remember me, but I was. And then I had the privilege of listening to him at the cathedral a few years ago in Electric Earth. And I must say how eloquent he is and how inspirational he is and what a person he is. You know, it is really nice to listen to Dr. Rock and to really enjoy his lecture. Dr. Rock, thank you for coming and joining us here this afternoon. We do appreciate it. I also want to take the opportunity to thank Dr. Ashley for coming here this afternoon and for gracing us with his presence and for inspiring us with that wonderful lecture, Human Development and Finding Our Identity. I trust that all of us who have already formed that identity will never lose it. Thank you very much. At this point, I want to take the opportunity to thank Dr. Malcolm Clark for his encouragement, his time, and his knowledge. He has been a wonderful leader. Thank you, Dr. I also want to thank, on your behalf, the teachers, Reverend Mongol, Reverend Rollins, Kendrick Sukaran, Jeff Eller, Selwyn McKillen, for their teaching, their patience, and putting up with us throughout the years that we were in class. Thanks for the opportunity, teachers. Thank you. Special thanks also go out to Ms. Lorraine Edwards and Shirley Smith for the encouragement and the support and for all the refreshments they have provided for us over the years. Thanks to the rector of St. Mary, my home church, Alphonse Daly, here. Baptized, married here, and also for those of you who don't know. For the rector, Reverend Peter Wood, and for the curate, Reverend Anderson Maxwell, for the use of the church, and also thanks to the wonderful choir, did a wonderful job with that. Thanks to the fellow students, their love and their friendship during the period over the years. I'm sure I speak for all of them and I say that we must thank Almighty God for his divine providence and protection throughout this period. As the scripture tells us,
We must put God first, and everything else should be added. In closing, I would like to say, and I'll take two words from Dr. Lashley's his sermon. I'm sure that he will never become schizophrenic. And in the process, we will all remain sane. None of us are going sane after the night. And I honestly believe that this is an opportunity for us, fellow students, to take it forward. Dr. Clark said, we are not here to recognize the whole thing, but to take the opportunity to make most of what we have learned and to continue forward and to increase our spirituality in whichever way we can. Thank you ever so much.
The book I'm selling, I am, if you look at the back of the church, there is a bookstore with some theological books and books that you can buy. That's what we brought it for. It's from the Metropolitan Bookstore. There we get our books, apart from Amazon and other places. Yeah, Metropolitan Bookstore. There, Mr. Cassin is at the bookstore, and then, of course, you will buy your book. Dr. Lashley is yet to tell you the price, but you will get to know the price when I tell you.
And I would also like to add to the thanks. I would like to thank the last round of applause, the audience for this evening.
Spirit be among you and be with you this night and forevermore. Amen. Amen.